thanks. I'm a hopefully last year PhD student at the University of Vienna. And actually, I studied astronomy, but I managed to sneak into a microbiological lab 3 years ago. And since then, I'm working there. And if you meet some of my colleagues, please don't tell them that I'm not a biologist at all. However, coming back to astronomy, I'm working on the habitability of Enceladus. And what is remarkably about Enceladus is not just his huge bulk density for an icy moon, which is higher than normal, which means that there must be some silicate rocks inside his core, but also what you should or have to know is, of course, the plumes found at the south polar region of Enceladus. And if you have a closer look into the composition of these plumes, you can see that we have plenty of stuff coming out of this moon. We have, of course, mainly water, but also CO2, CO, and other carbon hydrogens, and of course, where is it? Here, nitrogen, for example. So, if you, when I showed this table to a biologist, he said, "Wow, look at that! You can see so many potential products and substrates, or even both of methanogens." So, methanogens or methane-producing archaea are obligate anaerobes. They are chemotrophs, so they are totally independent of photosynthesis and all products done by photosynthesis. They are considered to have one of the earliest metabolism on Earth, and as you might see in the name, they produce methane as an integral part of their energy metabolism. And you can distinguish between four types of methanogens, depending on which substrate they use. So I'm looking at those using H2 and C1 compounds, namely those using H2 and CO2 to produce methane and H2O. I think yesterday someone mentioned the Fischer-Tropsch synthesis. This is the same, but the biological way, so the more effective way to produce methane and water. Good. So what about methanogens? What's the cool point about methanogens? They can be found in nearly all anaerobic environments on Earth. So you can find them at high and low salinity, at very low and very high pressure, at low and high pH, of course at even very high radiation, and in all kinds of temperature ranges. So you have psychophilic methanogens, but also one methanogen even resists more than 122 degrees Celsius, so you can't get rid of them when using an autoclave. However, my title says something about lipids, and when I started to work in biology, I was like, lipids? You don't know anything, so maybe some of you have the same knowledge about lipids like I had some months ago. So actually, you can distinguish archaea from bacteria and eukarya by their core membrane lipid composition. So what you can see here is, hopefully you can see it, is the different kinds of lipids found in archaea and bacteria. So here you can see the bacteria ones, which most likely have, which are most of the time bilayers, and the archaea ones often have monolayers, which makes them most likely more resistant against extreme environmental conditions like high or low temperatures, high salinity, or even dehydration. So I want to introduce you to you my best friend. It's Methanothermococcus okinawensis, because it's my buddy, I'm allowed to call him Oki. So Oki, his origin is in the deep sea hydrothermal chimney, I think in the Atlantic Ocean. And the optimal temperature is between 60 and 65 degrees, and optimal pH at around 6.7. Here you can see it. This photo I took from him myself, and this one I took from a paper, and it's a cocci, you can see. And so what's all about Oki? So what I've done with Oki is I somehow tried to figure out if it's possible that Oki can grow in Enceladus-like conditions. And when we have a look at the bloom composition, you can see that there are mainly four main potential inhibitors. So formaldehyde, methanol, ammonia in a higher content, and hydrogen cyanide. And I wanted to know if Oki can resist these, or yeah, can live in an environment where we can find those kind of molecules. And when I told my colleagues I want to work with hydrogen cyanide, they said, no way. And then I was, why not? Then I was looking up the, how to deal with hydrogen cyanide, and I was, no way, I won't ever work with that. So I asked some colleagues from the chemistry institute, and asked them, come on, look at the conditions at Enceladus. Is it possible that hydrogen cyanide, that the origin of the hydrogen cyanide found in the plume is inside the subsurface ocean? And they told me, nope, most likely it is, its origin is in the ice shell. And I was, okay, fine. So I don't have to test it. The others I had to test, and what I've done with them is a statistical method, a so-called DOE. So I was filling up around 50 to 60 of these small bottles, this size normally, and put those ingredients together with the normal growth media inside, and in different ratios of these inhibitors. So you can see here the design space. You can see the different axes. So we have the x-axis for ammonium chloride, the y-axis for formaldehyde, and the z-axis for methanol. And each point of this design space represents a certain amount of those three inhibitors or potential inhibitors. And what you can see is we can distinguish four different groups of those points, you say it like that. So we have those blue points, which means at very low amount of formaldehyde, but middle to high amount of ammonium chloride and various amounts of methanol, seems to have the best, the least influence on the growth of this methanogenic strain. So what you can see is measured is the OD, the optical density, because the more turbid the media gets, the better is the growth most likely, say it like that. So we have a second group here, those in green. You can see here we have those with a little bit more formaldehyde, and we have here the special case of this one, which has a high amount of ammonium chloride and a medium amount of formaldehyde. And we have those in red, where we have high amount of formaldehyde, very high amount here, and high amount of ammonium chloride and formaldehyde. So both together seems to be somehow inhibiting the growth. You can see it here now in a 3D model. And what you can see here is that here the slope is steeper, which means that formaldehyde seems to have a bigger influence on the growth than ammonium chloride. You can't see anything about methanol here, because methanol seems to have no influence on the growth, at least at the condition at the concentrations we tested. And then what about the lipids? So at the end, of the experiment, I harvest the biomass and send it to my colleagues in Hamburg, and they identified five kinds of lipids. And you can see we have those diethers and three kinds of tetraethers. And the most astonishing point for my colleagues in Hamburg was that those macrocyclic archaeol was we found it the first time in the genus Methanothermococcus, and those two kinds of tetraethers we found it the first time in the order Methanococcalis. So they were like pretty excited about that. Let's see if we can see some pattern in the statistics about those two kinds of lipids. Again, the blue ones, and what you can see here is that the difference that we can't see like the same pattern as in the OD. So we have the one which has the best growth, so the highest OD, not necessarily has the most amount of diether or tetraether. The same for the other groups, the same for the green groups, the orange one and the red one. And especially the tetraethers seems to have like a very similar amount all over the experiment. So this is very, very interesting, because formerly it was thought that it might be that when we stress methanogens, or that they produce more tetraeder, which doesn't look like that actually. So we can see it again in the 3D model. So we have the OD here, we have the D ethers. Again, we see that formaldehyde seems to have the bigger influence. And here we have the tetraethers, and here we can't really distinguish if formaldehyde or if ammonium chloride has the bigger influence. But we can see that it might be the case that there's more tetraether if we have less ammonium chloride and formaldehyde. So this thing about stress is good for producing tetraethers seems to be not that consensus with our data. Because I know you all want to go to the coffee break, I was really fast with my talk, so I'm already at my last slide. So to conclude, Okinawensis grows in the presence of multivariate concentration of potential inhibitors. And what I might have forgot to say is that the concentration we used in the in these experiments are this more or less the same as those found in Enceladus bloom in the data of 2009. Further, Okinawensis shows resistance to formaldehyde and ammonium chloride, but hardly no impact of methanol. But we have to say that there's a high impact on the absolute numbers of the different kinds of lipids, on the D ethers and the tetraethers, but in general, there's hardly no impact on the ratio between them. But if you have to look like on the smaller scale, so on the really like the single kinds of lipids, you can see an impact on those. So we have to think about like a statistical tool to describe this thing. And the last point is that we found new novel types of lipids for those organisms, which means, now comes the astrobiological relevant thing for future missions, if we use lipids as biomarkers, we should not expect to have the same lipids as on Earth, because what we saw in this experiment is that even if we change the environmental conditions a little bit, the pattern or even the ratio, the pattern, the ratio, even the types of lipids are changing. So if we go on another environment, we have to be aware that we shouldn't expect the same lipid ratios than we found in the lab. So in the end, I would like to thank, of course, Cassini. So thank you, Cassini, for all the data. Rest in peace. And my colleagues who helped me working in the lab, and of course, my colleagues in the Biological Institute. So thank you.
Oh, thank you very much.